message for you this morning on this great installation day. This is a powerful day. It is a wonderful day. It is a beautiful day for your church and for the pastor of this church as well. And we are all just honored to be able to share and to participate in this event of installation, celebration of the Zion Baptist Church. I want to just turn to a very familiar text. You've heard it many times. Hopefully, I have a different angle on it for you today. But you've heard it many times from the Gospel of Luke, the 8th chapter, the 22nd through the 25th verses. If you have your Bibles, you can turn with me to Luke chapter 8, beginning with verse 22. I see if you desire to stand, you can stand. Let me say a word to you about this standing in the church in terms of reading the scripture. Just a little historical fact that you may keep in your memory. And that is that during the early church, certainly during the second and third century church, there were no pews in the churches, okay? It was a pewless church, but that wouldn't work for a lot of us today. But there were no places to sit. You stood around the walls, okay? And so that's I'm pointing this out because that is the background, so to speak, of the standing in the church. But after people stood for so long, from the prelude to the postlude, they decided that it might be good to get some pews in the church. And if they're anything like the folk at my church in Richmond, having pews was not enough. They had to have cushioned pews in the church. And I see Zion ain't no different this morning. All right? We're turning to Luke now, chapter 8, verse 22, 23, 24, and 25. If everybody has it, amen. One day, he got into a boat with his disciples, and he said to them, "Let us go across to the other side of the lake." So they put out, and while they were sailing, he fell asleep. A windstorm swept down on the lake, and the boat was filling with water, and they were in danger. They went to him and woke him up, shouting, "Master, Master, we're perishing." And he woke up and rebuked the wind and the raging waves. They ceased, and there was a calm. He said to them, "Where is your faith?" They were afraid and amazed and said to one another, "Who then is this that he commands even the winds and the waves, and they obey him?" Let us pray. Gracious and eternal God, we thank you now for all of your blessings. We pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts will be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Let the people of God say amen.
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 Amen. Amen. You may be seated. My beloved brothers and sisters, based on this text, I want to say a word to you today from this text and based on this text and from the sermon title, Beyond Chaos and Calmness. Beyond Chaos and Calmness. A question of identity, beyond chaos and calmness. Say that to the person beside you so you won't forget. Beyond chaos and calmness, a question of identity. My beloved, I think most of you would agree with me that chaos seems to be everywhere. It is ubiquitous, it is pandemic. It is seen vividly in a storm, it is seen in a conflict, it's seen in the physical universe, and chaos is seen in the social order. Seen in the republic, in the nation, and in the hearts and in the minds of individuals. Chaos. Chaos is a state of confusion and disorder. It is unclarity, it is the lack of focus and the lack of direction. Chaos seems to be everywhere. Everywhere we look, in foreign policy, public policy, in government, national and local, in homes, in families, and also in the churches. Chaos. Now, on a national level, the United States provided Iraq with weapons of and materials of terror during Iraq's war with Iran, some of you may remember. And today, many of us, for the past 8 or 10 years, have been acting like terrorism is only practiced by other nations, when we ourselves have terrorized smaller nation states and other people within our borders, like African Americans, from the 17th century until the present day. Zion, who was it that enslaved a whole race of people while writing treatises on freedom and justice? Who was it that talked about democracy and human rights while at the same time denying blacks and women the right to vote? Who was it that put a reward on the head of two conductors of the Underground Railroad, Harriet Tubman and Sojourner Truth? I say to you this morning that black people have been terrorized long before the recent preoccupation with terrorism by the Democrats and the Republicans, by the Federalists and the states' rights advocates, by the Jeffersonians and the James Monroes, by the Knight Riders and the Ku Klux Klansmen, by the staunch segregationists as well as the graduates. So, my beloved, whether it's about the balance of power in the United States Senate, whether it's about an election in the local area, whether it's about what's going on in the city council here in Reading, Pennsylvania, whether it's about what's going on in the streets and in the communities, whether it's about any of this, chaos seems to be the order of the day. Chaos seems to be everywhere. In the cities, even small cities like Reading, Pennsylvania, people are being murdered. Folk are being shot in the head and wrapped in plastic bags and dumped in open streets, in alleys, in dumpsters, anywhere. Children are being murdered by strangers as well as by their own mothers and fathers. Others are being abused by moral leaders and teachers. The schools and the neighborhoods are often like war zones. People are being randomly shot and murdered by strangers who have gone on murderous rampages. Chaos and conflict, chaos and disorder have frightened, and they have caused fear and faithlessness everywhere we look and everywhere we turn. And so, my beloved, this morning, there are many who can readily identify with the reality and the spirit of this scripture text in the Gospel of Luke. One day he got into a boat with his disciples, and he said to them, "Let us go across to the other side of the lake." So they put out. While they were sailing, Jesus fell asleep, and a windstorm swept down on the lake. And the Bible says the boat was filling with water, and they were in danger. They went to him, and they woke him up, shouting, "Master, Master, we're perishing!" And he woke up and rebuked the wind and the raging waves, and they ceased. And the scripture says there was a great calm. He said to them, "Where is your faith?" They were afraid and amazed and said to one another, "Who then is this that he commands even the winds and the water, and they obey him?" I want you to know this morning, my beloved, that there is a striking difference between the attitude, the demeanor, and the behavior of Jesus and that of his own disciples. The disciples are overcome by terror, terrorized by the wind and the waves and the water, and Jesus is engulfed by the tranquil and peaceful posture of sleep. Jesus is calm, as evidenced by his sleep. Jesus is resting in the peace of God, while his disciples are terrified by the power of the same God. For Jesus, the nature of God is one of peaceful tranquility. For his disciples, God creates fear. The contrast in their reaction is due to their different understandings as to who God is. Jesus recognizes and knows who is in control of the universe, and because he recognizes who is in control of the universe, who is in control of the stars and the sun and the moon and the rain and the water and all of these things, because he recognizes who is in control, he goes to sleep. He absolutely connects with God. He trusts God. He understands who God is as creator and redeemer. Yet his disciples understand neither God nor the Son of God, Jesus Christ, as Savior and Lord. Why else would they be in such a tizzy? Like the church. Why else would they be in such a frenzy? Like the church. Why else would they be in such a torrid and totalizing terror, causing them to totter on the brink of anguish and anxiety? They say, Jesus, we are going under. We are about to perish. They're fled out afraid and scared. They panic, shouting, wake up, Master, wake up. The truth is, my beloved brothers and sisters, they were in worse danger before the storm than they are in now. They just didn't recognize it, and they didn't know it. In other words, it's not the storm that puts them in a dangerous position, but it's their lack of faith, their lack of understanding who Jesus is. They were in danger, but not necessarily from this storm, because Jesus is in fact on the boat. God can and God does bring order out of chaos. Some of you know what I'm talking about, because you have been surrounded by chaos. You've been living in the midst of chaos. Chaos is going on all around you, in your community, in your home, in your family, and even in your churches. But I'm here to tell you today that God is a God who can get this chaotic situation straightened up and straightened out. This story identifies Jesus with God. The incarnation is evident here. God was in Christ Jesus. Jesus woke up and rebuked the wind and the raging waves. And the Bible says they ceased and there was a calm. This chaos represented by the stormy, angry sea is subject to the power of God through Jesus Christ. Jesus restores order to primordial chaos just as God did in Genesis chapter 1. But more importantly, the stormy sea and the chaotic waters reflected the disciples' inner chaos. It reflected something going on in their hearts and in their minds, their inability to recognize who Jesus really is. And we ain't got no greater ability today than they had then. We come to church every Sunday. We participate in every organization and auxiliary. We've been a part of the organization and the institution of the church for many years. Fathers, grandfathers, grandmothers, and others have sung in the choir and served in the diaconate. And yet, we still act like we don't know who Jesus is. Listen, my beloved. Even the wind and the waves obey him. Yet his disciples, those who sat at his feet and listened to his teachings, day in and day out, week in and week out, still are not able to adhere to his teachings and don't really know him, and they show it in their actions. Follow me closely now. The water, the raging sea, the deluge and the demons, Hurricane Isidore and Hurricane Lily cannot resist the power of the Almighty God. Leprosy, disease, blindness cannot resist the power of God. The blind are given their sight, the lame walk, and those with diseases are healed. Even the dead are brought to life by the authority of God through Jesus Christ. And yet, his own disciples, and yet, those who sit at his feet, and yet, those who come to prayer meeting and Bible study, and yet, those who are being taught on a daily basis, They did not do what they had heard. His word had not taken root in their hearts and in their souls. And they did not know calmness. But they didn't know peace, and neither did they know trust. When the waves and the wind could obey his will, his own disciples couldn't do it. Doesn't that interest you today? Doesn't that seem strange? Doesn't that seem funny? Doesn't that seem curious today? Why is it that moving from chaos to calmness ain't enough? Well, when the storm is over, we got some folks who still ain't satisfied. Y'all know what I'm talking about. This is a Baptist church, isn't it? They're not convinced about themselves or our Savior. There are those who maintain a lingering identification with chaos. It seems to me that we have to stop being in complicity with chaos. Some folk in the church seem to be more at peace when a lot of ruckus is going on. Y'all may not be like that up here in Reading, but I'm talking about the folk in Virginia. The disciples identify with chaos. Their terror and faithlessness suggest their propensity to be in solidarity with chaos. And we got some folk like that in our own community. As long as there is a storm, as long as there is something going on to cause tension, as long as there is terror, as long as there is chaos in the family, in the community, in the church, these folk are fine. Their self-understanding, their practice of faith and ministry are grounded in chaos. Some folk ain't satisfied by peace, some folk ain't satisfied by tranquility, and some of us won't rest until we find something with which we can identify. Chaos. Chaos in our organization. Chaos in our auxiliary. Chaos. I know we got a new pastor, but I still got some things I'm concerned about. Chaos. I know we got a new pastor, but I feel it all of that stuff he's talking about. Chaos. I know we got a new pastor, but I ain't for all of that change. Chaos. Chaos everywhere. Everywhere we turn. We are like Jesus' disciples because we identify with their faults, their failures, and their faithlessness. And I want you to understand today, Zion Baptist Church, that we identify more with Jesus' disciples than we do with Jesus himself. We have what I call a disciples' theology. A theology that reads a biblical text and instead of saying what the ideal is that Jesus is emulating and talking about, we focus on what the disciples are doing. And they are always problematic. Then Jesus asked his disciples, where is your faith? Where is your faith? The Bible says that they were afraid and amazed. And so, my beloved, moving from chaos to calmness ain't enough because we have to get to the point of faith. I know we are a church. And I know we've been in this church for many years, let's say 100 years or more. But we still have to get to the point of faith. The absence of faith remains a residual even after the storm has obediently responded to the voice of God and to the power of God. The text says that Jesus rebuked or ordered the wind and the waves to cease, to stop. The power of the word is reflected in Jesus' speech to the physical elements. The winds and the waves calming down in absolute obedience to his will.
This is further evidence of the incarnation that his disciples completely missed. Jesus then asked, where's your faith? Don't you have any faith? If you have faith, where is it? Is your faith vacationing at the bottom of the sea? Or has the wind blown your faith into oblivion? Where's your faith? Where's your understanding of the power of God? And who do you understand yourself to be? Self-understanding, Zion, always occurs through understanding something other than yourself. Where's your faith? How are you going to be able to preach and teach? How are you going to be able to tell the story of your experience? How are you going to be able to talk about your relationship with the Son of God? How are you going to be able to talk about the Son of Man and the Son of David? How are you going to talk about what the Lord has done for you? How are you going to talk about how far the Lord has brought you? Notice now that the storm is over. Everything should be back to normal. But the text says that the pre-response to Jesus' question was, they were frightened and amazed. Frightened and amazed. Notice the correlation. Notice the dialectic. They were afraid and amazed. They were disturbed and apprehensive. On the one hand, and confused and stunned and astonished on the other. This calming of the storm, this cessation of chaos, creates fear, because while they had maybe a little understanding of how the sea and the wind and the waves were subject to the erratic and unruly action and behavior, their understanding of Jesus is less clear, because Jesus is more powerful than the storm. And they could not understand that. How could this man be more powerful than the storm? Indeed, the bringing of calmness and comfort to the disciples, being in Jesus' presence, instead of bringing them calmness, instead of bringing them comfort, it created fear and amazement. Oh, my beloved, as they said to one another, who then is this that he commands even the winds and the water, and they obey him? Who then is this? Who is this? What a question. They still do not know him after he has transformed chaos into calmness. The sea is no longer raging and the winds have ceased. The trouble is over. And they still ask him, who then is this? My beloved, yes, I don't know what you've gone through, but you have a new pastor now. I don't know what you've gone through, but the Lord has brought you through it. I don't know what you've gone through, but the Lord has made a way out of no way. I don't know what you've gone through, but the Lord has been in the midst of it all. And yet we still got some folk up in here asking, who then is this? Who then is he? Who is he? Finally then, my beloved, I want you to know that moving from chaos to calmness ain't enough, because the identity question is still hanging out there. Who is Jesus? Who then is this? This is the moment. This is the question. This is the opportunity to reconcile the dialectic between meaning and event, between speech and action. Jesus has commanded that chaos cease. Jesus has spoken, and the wind and the sea have been made mute. Jesus' speech has been obviated and has obviated the outspoken, howling, boisterous sounds of the wind and the waves. Jesus is the voice. Jesus is the speech. Jesus is the Logos. Jesus is the power of God. Oh, this event, like all events, would vanish. It would pass away like the withering of grass or the fading of flowers. But it is how this event is understood. What this event means becomes the foundation, the starting point for proclaiming the gospel. They are questioned to one another, though grounded in a thick disconnect and distance between them and Jesus. Nevertheless, it's a question that must be answered this morning. This is indeed a very important question, a very relevant question. I say to you today, Zion, your family is well. Your children are all healthy and safe. You have been in the hospital, and now you're back at home. You've had surgery, and now you're on the mend. You can walk again. You have the activity of your limbs. And you sit here this morning clothed and in your right mind. Then God has blessed you. Your speech is no longer slurred. Your family is doing well. The doctor has given you a clean bill of health. You have a job, and your bills are being paid. The storm is over. The storm is over. And you are still asking, who is this?